very, very good example about where British English is going, if you want sort of phonetics. Because the Queen is a very good example of what happens to RP when it goes a little bit wrong, because she doesn't open her mouth.
Anyhow, everything is done for this very small opening.
And it's, if you try imitating her, you get an impression of where the noise is coming from and how difficult it is to speak like that. I learnt French as a small boy, and I learnt it with an English accent, and it was awful. And then I lived in Greece for a while, about 20 years ago, and I had two French friends. One was young, and one was an old man. And the old man had an accent like Inspector Clouseau, and it was wonderful. And by imitating him, I suddenly realized what French sounded like. So, come in. I don't know you. You are entirely new. Who are you?
From 404th Group.
Yes, but what is your name?
Sasha.
Sasha, you are very welcome, even from the 404th Group. So are you reading about a boy as well? You've all read about a boy. Oh, I think first of all we have to applaud you. Come in. There were so many references in About a Boy that I knew, and that I realised, come, there's so many seats here, and that I realised maybe you would not know. For example, what is Pinky and Perky? Pinky and Perky. Did anybody wonder what Pinky and Perky was? Do you remember, right at the beginning, Will is looking in a record shop and Angie is looking at Pinky and Perky records.
It was a children's show.
Yes, but do you know what it was?
Jinx.
Did you look it up on the internet?
Yes.
Oh, how clever of you, how brilliant of you. I loved Pinky and Perky was in my childhood. And I remember Pinky and Perky with tremendous affection. All they'd done was to speed up the recording, so Pinky and Perky had this incredibly high-pitched voice, and they sang popular songs from the day. They sang the Beatles and things like that. And then they were little marionettes of pigs. And they were really rather useless, but it was tremendous fun. And so, yes. The other thing I realised reading it last night... Two other things popped into my head, which I wanted to share with you today, and I haven't written them down in my talk. In fact, my talk is a little bit messy. Two things struck me. Number one, I couldn't find very much reported speech. There's almost no reported speech. Almost everything is direct speech. And number two, I could not imagine anybody other than Hugh Grant playing the part of Will. Was it written for him? It reads like a play. And have I told you that Hugh Grant and I are contemporaries and that we were at Oxford together? And we made a film together called Privileged, which was the first film Hugh Grant made. Of course, Hugh Grant's name is on the film. My name is not. But we started a sort of film society in Oxford called the Oxford Film Foundation. Hello. And have a seat. There's seats here. And Privileged was the first film that we made. And there have been other films made since then, but no feature films. And Hugh Grant, of course, was the star of the film. And Hugh has made... He's made a reputation, really, for playing bumbling Englishman, and this is a very good bumbling Englishman. Does anybody know what job he does? Or how he gets his money? Because it is actually specified in the book. Yes, where does he get his money from? There's a whole section about it.
His father
wrote a Christmas song, and he's getting royalties from the Christmas song. So it's all about copyright. And copyright is very exciting. And in fact, in a previous talk that I gave in the English department, I think we touched on copyright very briefly. One of the advantages about living in the Soviet Union was because it was isolated from the rest of the world, it could ignore copyright. And so there are, there is, for example, the cartoon film of Winnie the Pooh, for which I'm sure the Soyuz Mult film or whoever made it did not pay any money to, is it E.H. Shepherd or was he the illustrator? I can't remember. He's the illustrator. A.A. Milne or A.A. Milne's family. And I'm certain that P.L. Travers was never paid any money from the adaptation of Mary Poppins. Because she hated the Disney adaptation so much, she wouldn't actually allow anyone else to make a film of it. So copyright is a very entertaining subject. In England, there is a tradition now among the left wing, that is the socialist people, to consider a thing called copyleft, which is a sort of an open rights agenda where people can just simply pilfer what other people have been doing and not pay money. But for that, I think the principle is that they don't sell their work. They give it away. The internet is a serious problem for copyright. If you are going to put up a video on YouTube, be very careful that you don't use anybody's music, because your video will be taken down and your channel could well be closed for copyright infringement. So somebody like Will is actually living on the royalties, on the money that comes from a copyright arrangement. And he's actually living very comfortably. And again, the list of the singers who have sung his father's song is very familiar to me. I would imagine it would be quite unfamiliar to you. But again, it's worth looking up on the internet to see the full range, because what he's saying with that is that the full range of singers have actually sung my father's song. Everybody, from Bing Crosby to Cilla Black and Elvis Presley. Now, what I wanted to do in our talk, if you don't mind, just bear with me, and I'm going to throw out lots of questions to you, because this is not really one of my formal lectures. This is a little bit of a sort of crossover. I started in the week. I wrote a piece about Shakespeare, which was going to be a formal talk. And then we had a meet. We met in the corridor, and so since then I'm doing something on about a boy and the British novel. So I can't remember. Did we meet 2 days ago? One day?
Two days ago.
So this is 2 days, and most of last night. All right. So what I wanted to do today was to look at what I consider to be the great novels of the 21st century. And I thought quite long and hard about this. And I thought, do I like any novels in the 21st century? And once I started writing these down, I realised there's actually quite a lot of novels that we can choose. And so what is my purpose in today? Number one, I want to stimulate you to talk a little bit to me about a boy. But number two, I'm sure you don't need any stimulation. I'm sure you're eager to tell me all your thoughts about a boy. But number two, I want to send you off with ideas that you are going to go and buy a book or download a book from Kindle. My edition of About a Boy is on Kindle, is on the computer. It's wonderful. But I want you to read books. Oh, my goodness, did I bring... No, I didn't bring it. I was going to show you a book. So I've gone through a series of books in my mind, on paper. I checked I've got the names right. And I'm going to tell you about, I think, 10 authors or so. Of those, I'm going to select 4. And there's one of those books which I think you should all read as students who have only recently been children. And if you have not read this book, shame on you! And don't think you can escape into the film, because the film is dreadful. So, If anybody can from what I've told you, can anybody imagine what book I'm going to recommend?
Harry Potter.
No!
Maybe Cloud Atlas.
No, but that's a very, very good guess. Have you read it?
No.
Ah, nor have I.
Maybe it was something of Charles Dickens.
No, no, 21st century. And it just gets into the 21st century. Just gets into the actual book that's been filmed is from the 20th century. So there's three books in this series, and the third book was written in 2000. So it sort of, I thought it just qualified. The film had Nicole Kidman in it, and Daniel Craig.
Total Illumination.
What do you call it? Yeah, that sounds fairly like it. You're translating directly from
Daniel
Russian, aren't you?
Daniel suffered first. Total Illumination.
No, I think we're probably.
Everything's illuminated, but that's in America.
No, no, this is very much a British author. He actually lives in Oxford. He used to teach in a school in Oxford. Now he's retired from the school, and he wrote his books in a shed at the bottom of the garden. Yes, who said that?
I'm not sure who wrote it.
No, it's Philip Pullman. Okay. Philip Pullman. And it's called The Golden Compass in America. It's called Northern Lights in Britain. The film, sadly, is called The Golden Compass. The Golden Compass is the first of three books. The Golden Compass, The Subtle Knife. And I know I've talked about this somewhere before. I think it was in this university. I seem to remember using the word subtle knife and realising, oh gosh, that's a difficult word, subtle. The Subtle Knife, and the third one is The Amber Spyglass, and The Amber Spyglass won the Booker Prize for that year, I think. Or maybe it just won the Smith's Prize, I mean, anyway, it won an award. And the Amber Spyglass is the least good of the three books, but I think by the time he got his third book out, people wanted to give him prizes. It's a little bit like giving Judi Dench the Oscar for playing Queen Elizabeth in Shakespeare in Love. She was barely on screen for more than 3 minutes. But because she lost the Oscar the year before, come in! They obviously felt she deserved something. There's lots of seats over here. On that side, you have to sit on top of somebody's lap. On this side, look, so much space. So I'm looking at the books that I consider important, and I'm trying to encourage you to go out and buy some of these books. If you don't buy them, look at bits of them on the internet. Download a Kindle edition and then share it. Buy a book, give it to a friend. Oh gosh, I've done something silly. There we are, right now. So the first 10 years of the 20th century produced some of the greatest literature in the world. Did the first 10 years of the 21st century do the same thing? Maybe not. In the first 10 years of the 20th century, you have Proust, Swan in Love, anyway, Swan's Way. You have Heart of Darkness, which I think is one of the great novels and is something very important. Ooh, gosh. I hope you're going to sing at the same time. Heart of Darkness, terribly important because it's written by somebody who was not English. He was writing in English, a Polish man writing in English. This is really your mission. You're learning English, you should be writing the next great English novel, and you could be up there with Conrad, and I will be saying when I'm terribly old, oh, I knew her, or I knew him. You're going to do it, aren't you? You're going to do it. Excellent. What's your name?
My name is Olga.
Olga, and next to you?
Bulad.
Bulad. Bulad.
Yes,
right. Bulad. And then?
Dasha.
And then?
Sasha.
The next novel is coming out of those four. We don't know how, but you know, you can see it in their eyes. There's a sort of twinkle. Olga's going to write it. Yes, helped by Dasha. And Bulat. Excellent. Right. So Heart of Darkness, terribly important. The Scarlet Pimpernel, which is awful, but made quite a lot of films. The Wizard of Oz was published in this time in about 1909, I think, the first. And Frank L. Baum then published something like 20 volumes of The Wizard of Oz. Thank God most of those were not filmed. Then back to England. Howard's Way, one of the great novels of E.M. Forster. He only wrote six. So, you know, whenever he published a novel, that's important. But one of the great ones was written in that period. Death in Venice by Thomas Mann. We can even go over to Germany. You know, anything by E.M. Forster, anything by Thomas Mann, anything by Proust, obviously. These are the great novels of the world, of all time. All written in that 10-year period from 1900 to 1910. And before that we have... What is it? First Men in the Moon by H.G. Wells. That's at the end of the 19th century. And anyway, just have a look at the books which are published in that period. And then have a look at the books which have been published now in the first 10 or 15 years of the 21st century. Some of them are good and some of them are awful. Now, I think at the top of the list is a man called Sebastian Faulks. Have you come across him? Birdsong, tremendous novel about the First World War. Devil May Care. Ooh, Devil May Care. Do you remember James Bond? James Bond by E.M. Fleming. E.M. Fleming was doing in sort of popular fiction what George Orwell... Is it George Orwell? Animal Farm? Yes. What George Orwell was recommending in serious fiction. What George Orwell was saying is simplify your writing. He'd been trained as a journalist. Only say what is necessary. Don't use adverbs. Adverbs imply you've got the wrong verb. Adjectives are very nice. Ian Fleming. Ian Fleming does that for sort of the racy, exciting page-turner. And he writes something rather brilliant. If you haven't read any of the James Bond books, I highly recommend that you do, particularly on Her Majesty's Secret Service, which is a really rather good novel. It's not very flashy, but it's a good novel. I don't recommend you read From Russia with Love. I tried reading that to a Russian boy, or with a Russian boy in England, and he kept saying to me, oh, these are rude words. These are very rude words. And because I said to him, well, I read all the English, you read the Russian, I can't read this. Why not? It's very rude. I don't know where Ian Fleming got all those words from. Certainly, I've never heard them in Moscow. And I wrote them down. But Devil May Care is part of a new... Come in! Ooh, seat. Devil May Care is part of a new tradition of writing books in the style of a dead author and preserving that literary heritage, because the Bond stories still continue in the cinema with second-rate stories invented by film writers. And so we've taken some of the great British writers and American writers. They've been asked by the Bond estate, we're back to copyright, to write authentic James Bond stories that continue the James Bond literary tradition. And Sebastian Faulks wrote the first one called Devil May Care, and it's actually a tremendous introduction to the whole tradition, and it's an introduction, if you want it, to Sebastian Faulks, who is one of the great modern English writers. So read Devil May Care, and then be really daring and read Charlotte Gray, A Possible Life, Birdsong. He's even written a book which is not a novel. He's written a biography, and it includes, amusingly, it's a biography about somebody who got involved in spying between Britain and Moscow in the 1960s. And I remember I had a friend at school called, called Angus. And he told me these incredibly tall stories. What's a tall story? Do you know? A tall story is a lie. So I thought these were tall stories about how he had smuggled important documents out of Moscow in a sweet, in a packet of sweets when he was about 5 years old. And that his father was had some important role in the British... in the British Embassy, and he was head of the British Secret Service in Moscow. And it all sounded very exciting. And then his father died in mysterious circumstances. And again, we had interesting stories. And then later, about 10 years ago, his mother died. And suddenly, on the pages of the Times, very important newspaper, was the entire story about how his mother had liaised with a Russian spy who was passing secrets to Britain, and they were being carried out of Britain in the sweet papers of her son. And all of this is in the Sebastian Faulks book, which is called The Fatal Englishman, and it looks at three different people from the 20th century, and part of the story is this extraordinary thing that I realised I was told when I was a schoolboy that obviously nobody else knew, and that was completely true. And one way to enjoy novels is to find some sort of link between the novel and your life. There's not very many British novels set in Moscow. But if there are some, read them. That's a terribly good starting point. What we want to know... whenever I read a biography, I read a lot more biographies. You know, elderly people read a lot of biographies. But what they're doing, they're looking in these biographies. Ooh, did this person manage to do anything before they were 20? Oh, they did. Oh, dear. did they manage to do anything before they were 30? Oh, they did. Oh, dear. I think that's what we do. As we get a little bit older, we get very, very competitive about how much other people manage to achieve. And I know I'm terribly keen to check out people's ages. And it can be disappointing, but it can be very exciting. And you look at all these links. And sometimes I think you read novels because you're told to read them and you don't see any great links between yourself and the novel. So you need to select novels based on the links. There are many links. Simply pursuing a boyfriend or a girlfriend is not a big enough link, I find, because they tend to occur in many novels. But finding the complexity of that is tremendous fun. There's a lady called Charlotte Mandelson who's written a novel recently called, what's her name here? Almost English. It's about five people sharing an apartment. And sharing apartments is something we've all done. Maybe some of you are doing it at the moment. And this is wonderful. I don't know how many of you heard my other talk about the death of the novel, but sharing an apartment is obviously one way to write a novel because the various people are forced to be linked together. They're linked together by their environment. I've been doing quite a lot of work in the last 2 weeks looking at some essays about... Soviet architecture and the Khrushchevs?
Mm-hmm. Khrushchev.
Yes, Khrushchev, mm-hmm. Which are these five-story mm-hmm. apartments without a lift. Mm-hmm. And I've been reading these wonderful things with people complaining about how many stairs we have to climb. You have it lucky. It was much colder in Moscow in those days. And it's a wonderful combination of of fantasy and reality, because of course it probably isn't much colder in Moscow in those days, but certainly at the moment it does seem very warm. I want to throw my window open. I find it very odd having central heating that is controlled by somebody else. Now I understand why when Russian students come to stay with me, they always complain that it's too cold. Because they find out where the thermostat is. And they go and say, it's very cold. And I say, oh, is it? It seems very hot to me. And it's a sort of game which we play all day long, really. And I think they're being extravagant. But your houses, your apartments in Moscow are so much warmer than our apartments, mm-hmm. our houses in Britain. We think that if it's cold, you just get a dog or a cat. You think if it's cold, you put on another jumper, you close the windows. But the heating is already very good. And people say to me, oh, it's very cold, and they're sitting in these wonderful heated classrooms. And I think, no, it's very hot, I can hardly survive. I'm going to start tearing my tie off any minute. Right, so, people sharing a flat. There was a wonderful television series in the 1990s, which again I recommend if anybody can get hold of the series, you can probably download it from somewhere. Called This Life. It's about lawyers sharing an apartment, sharing a house in London. And again, you've got that wonderful friction between people who are forced to live together. And other than that, they have nothing in common. Tremendous opportunities. Almost as good as Iris Murdoch. Incidentally, Iris Murdoch doesn't feature on my list, because Iris Murdoch had died before 2000. Ian McEwan. If you haven't read any Ian McEwan, or if you don't know his name, pretend that you've read Ian McEwan, because Ian McEwan is one of the great writers of modern British literature. You've all seen Atonement. Mm-hmm. Yes, Keira Knightley. Read the book. Well. Read the book. Child in Time. Child in Time, about a child that goes missing, and because it's such a traumatic experience, she's always that age for the parents. Absolutely true, of course. The Comfort of Strangers, Enduring Love, almost anything by Ian McEwan is worth reading. It's a little more difficult than Sebastian Faulks. I'm doing this in terms of difficulty, incidentally. The next one on my list is a Japanese person, Kazuo Ishiguro, The Remains of the Day. But when you look at the film of The Remains of the Day, or you read the book, you think, well, this must be written by somebody who is absolutely English. But sometimes, somebody who has come from a different culture and a different country can see us more truly as we are. Robbie Burns, the great Scottish poet, who is always remembered at New Year when everybody sings for Auld Lang Syne, my dear. I will tack a cup of kindness yet for the sack of Auld Lang Syne. A cup of kindness is whiskey. So Ishiguro, Robbie Burns. You see, I can actually do that. When I think of Scottish people. Robbie Burns. You're impressed, aren't you? I could almost learn Russian like this. I would have to put on a kilt. My father had a kilt. It was very dark, sort of. My father's kilt was the sort of colour that you would get if you weren't very good at painting in oils. Everything was sort of brown and black and rather ugly. I'm sure it started off as red and rather lovely. But every family has a particular kilt. And you have to find out which clan you belong to. My father belonged to the Gunn clan. Now, we know of Gunn because of Treasure Island, don't we? Ben Gunn, completely mad. So was my father. And and I inherited his kilt. Now it doesn't seem to fit so well. But I could stand in a kilt and I could be very, very Russian. because in order to speak like a Scottish person, you have to roll the R's. Anyway, Robbie Burns said comes out with a wonderful poem, and in the middle of the poem he says, "To see ourselves as others see us." It's terribly important to be able to see ourselves as others see us. And because we're not normally so objective, we need somebody from outside to come along. And again, the call for you to write the next great British novel, please do so. There's so little time left. You have to harness these energies. Be creative. Read other people and be creative yourself. How many people here keep a diary? Good. Just two, three, four. I bore.
Bulat.
Bulat. You get better and better. I know we have to have a talk. I will tell you what chapters to write. I'll practically write it for you. So the remains of the day, if you haven't read the book, read at least one or two chapters. It's one of these wonderful reflective books. It is really for the 21st century. It's in fact, it was written in the 20th century. It's a late 20th century version of *Brideshead Revisited*. If you haven't read *Brideshead Revisited*, one of the great novels, one of the great British novels, *Brideshead Revisited*. If you haven't read the book, go and see the BBC TV series. Do not watch the film, but watch the BBC TV series. Again, like About a Boy, it deals with humour. And that you can see a very nice through line from Jane Austen through to Evelyn Waugh, through, I think, to a certain extent, to Nick Hornby. This idea of understated humour, that the humour is not necessarily what people say, though there's a lot of that in Nick Hornby, but it's also in the comments which are made by the author after they say something. That's terribly exciting, and the use of irony. In *Brideshead Revisited*, there's a wonderful scene which is literally taken out of the book and put on the television screen, and the protagonist's father, who is played by a wonderful old actor called John Gielgud, goes to visit his friend Sebastian Flight in Castle Brideshead, and he says, "Oh, I've got to see my friend." "Who? Is there some reason?" "Oh, he's very ill." "Oh dear, I'm so sorry." And when the boy comes back, the father, who isn't really a very good father, he's not very interested in his son, he's eating at the dinner table, says, "And your friend, did he die?" "No." "Oh, I'm so pleased. I was very concerned." And you just think, yeah, I know these people. I know these people. I don't know if they exist in Russia, but they certainly exist in England. People who somehow have detached themselves from all emotion. Tremendous. And a lot of *Brideshead* is about reflecting on the past. If you're reflecting on the past, suddenly you have an opportunity to add humorous asides, because you are reflecting on what has already happened. When you're in the middle of it, the room for humour isn't so great, and somebody else has to add that. But you, as the person who's taking part in the event, when you are reflecting on what happened in the past, you can be humorous, and you often are. So we've got that from The Butler in The Remains of the Day, but the modern novel, The Unconsoled. Scarlett Thomas, The End of Mr. Y. It's about a manuscript which gets found, and it's a little bit fantastic. The main character gets lost in an alternate dimension. If anybody is a fan of Doctor Who, there is an opportunity for you. Or maybe in a galaxy far, far away. Has anybody seen it yet? A galaxy far, far away. Bom, 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 ba-dom, bom, ba-dom. Yes. Anyway, we could talk about leitmotifs for a few minutes, but we'll do that later. Hanif Qureshi. Anybody come across Hanif Qureshi? He's a playwright, he's a filmmaker, and he's an author. Very good. In the 1980s, he wrote a book called Buddha of Suburbia. The Buddha of Suburbia. Good book. Alan Hollinghurst. Do you know this? A little bit difficult. The Line of Beauty. John le Carré. The Perfect Spy. You know the Smiley books? You don't know the Smiley books, do you? The Smiley books are sort of more authentic spy novels. So James Bond is not authentic. The Smiley books really are fairly authentic, I think. Of course, once the Berlin Wall comes down, John le Carré's life changes and he starts writing slightly different books. But his books are always thoughtful. They're intelligent spy stories. Salman Rushdie. Salman Rushdie is famous for having a fatwa issued against him by the Ayatollah Khomeini for a book called The Satanic Verses. The moment the fatwa was issued, I went out and got hold of a copy of the book, and then I tried to read it. I must say, although there were one or two pages that were interesting, a lot of it really did seem as if it would be more suitably burnt, which the Ayatollah Khomeini and his friends indulged in. Now, there was book burning, like something out of Hitler. Really, we don't want to burn books, and we want to read things that people tell us we shouldn't read. The days when we are told we can read this and we can't read this, these days should be past. We have the internet. But Salman Rushdie, probably one of the greatest books of the 20th century, was Midnight's Children. At the end of the 20th century, he wrote a book for children called Haroon and the Sea of Stories. Midnight's Children is very difficult to read. Anything by Salman Rushdie for grown-ups is difficult to read. But Haroon and the Sea of Stories is an introduction to this great author. Money by Martin Amis. Again, Martin Amis. Anything by Martin Amis must be good. Muriel Spark. I don't know why I'm mentioning these, because none of these are from the 21st century. Muriel Spark. Has anybody read The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie? Have you seen the film?
Yes. Yes.
You've seen the film. Read the book. It's very short. There's two books which are worth reading. What's the other one? Because we talked about it in the class we did. The thing which then becomes Don't Look Now. I can't remember who wrote it, but it's also well. These little novels, novelettes, or whatever you call them, short stories, well worth reading. Find a short story by one of these great authors, then at least you've got access to one of the great authors. But walking around the place, not having read any of these people, and claiming to be studying English, this is a great failing. So you have to read some of these people. And don't just read what you're told to read. This is also boring. Make a decision. Go and buy something really brave. Edward St. Aubin has written a series of detective novels based on a person called Patrick Melrose. No, they're not really detective novels. They're more of a sort of attempt at... more of an attempt at a British version of Marcel Proust. I don't know whether this is that successful. I enjoyed at least one of them. I think it was called Mother's Milk. A.S. Byatt. You've come across Possession. Have you come across Possession? No. Come across Possession. The Biographer's Tale. Hilary Mantel. Have you come across Hilary Mantel? Have you seen the television adaptation of her books about Cromwell? About Henry VIII? And you know, it's all very exciting and bloody. Every other hour he's chopping somebody's head off. Very, very exciting. Well, there's two novels that she's written so far. One is called Wolf Hall. The other one is called Bring Up the Bodies. And the third one, I think, is called The Mirror and the Light, or The Light and the Mirror. She's not finished yet. We're all eagerly awaiting it. As I said in my talk about the death of the novel, this is historical fiction, so it's safe. But it is also rather brilliant. What has she done? She's taken a character from history who is universally condemned, and she's made him into her hero. And she's made the person who is universally celebrated as a great Renaissance man, a great man of learning, a great religious man, a martyr. She's made him into a sort of villain. And it's just so refreshing to see somebody turn that upside down. Think of the things, when you're a novelist, you always have to think about what is going to be surprising. What is going to be surprising, and then add more surprise. If you think you can anticipate what's going to happen next, turn it upside down, change it. That's how you get the excitement when you are writing. And you have to do even more of that when you write a play. A lot of your work is, as I gather, is about phonetics and about the way we speak. So you should have been looking at drama. You're looking up there. I'm so sorry. Have you looked at any British drama, particularly from the 1920s, 1930s, where we had these sort of very, very tight little dramas by people like Terence Rattigan, Noel Coward? Have you read any Noel Coward? Have you seen any Noel Coward? Noel Coward. I was always told that that you couldn't play Noel Coward with the principles of Stanislavski. Stanislavski taught us all that when we are on stage, we have to think of the part, we have to think of the emotions of the part, and then project those emotions into what we say. We already have the words written out, but we have to live those emotions. And because we understand the characters, because we learn what the characters are like, we know what they will say, and they do indeed say what's written on the page. You get rather strange things where, as a director, you tell somebody to move across the stage. My character wouldn't do that. British actors tended to adopt Stanislavski techniques rather late. Some of them refused completely. We believed that it was better just simply to love the voice. But today, a course on Stanislavski's principles is almost essential for any actor. It is quite exciting to be in Moscow at the heart of this revolution in acting, because before Stanislavski, people learnt a code of where to put your hand when you were saying something. I love you. Go away. Go. But now we think, you know, these gestures come from inside us, come from our emotions. Tremendous. One of the things that Stanislavski talks about is a thing called subtext. And subtext informs all our writing. And we now have the language to talk about it because we got it from Stanislavski. Subtext. And we tend to think that plays which were written in the early 20th century didn't have subtext. We tend to think that plays, for example, in Germany by people like Bertolt Brecht didn't have subtext. I can tell you absolutely, there's a wonderful scene in The Good Person of Szechuan, I don't know if you know this play, where there is an absolute, there's a love scene, and neither of the characters talk about being in love until right at the end, so they are playing a subtext all the way through. And so you have to play that subtext, otherwise it doesn't make sense at the end. They're talking about a plane, they're talking about flying, but in fact, their real conversation is about being in love. And you find the same thing with Noel Coward. Noel Coward, in a play called Private Lives, wonderful conceit, the curtain goes up and you see a facade of a hotel in the south of France, in Cannes. And you've got two balconies and there's a little bush and a thing in the middle dividing the two apartments. And Elliot has just got married to his second wife. He had a very unpleasant divorce. And he comes out onto the balcony and he hears his previous wife in the other balcony, who's also just got married again, Amanda. And so Elliot and Amanda, in the moonlight, While there's a band playing one of the songs that Noel Coward, the author, wrote, and he says, very potent cheap music. How potent cheap music can be. And they start by trading insults. And then they start reminiscing. And of course, they end up running off together, leaving their new spouses. And it only works if you play subtext, that scene. It's before anybody knew in England about Stanislavski. And it's simply because subtext is the natural way to write. We are always going to write a conversation that we don't quite have. And that's what's so exciting when you get a book like About a Boy, which is full of dialogue, you have to look at the subtext. What are the characters actually saying? Not the words that are written down, but how do you join those words together to make conversation that's actually happening in the head? What are they not saying on the page that they are thinking about? Because that's what's linking these sentences. And in the Private Lives, Eliot says, and I travelled round the world. How was the world? And did you see the Taj Mahal? I've always heard it was very big, like a biscuit box. And by moonlight, the Taj Mahal looks so bewitching by moonlight. Oh, I do love you terribly, terribly, terribly. The subtext is nothing about travelling around the world. And there's all these wonderful lines which could have been written by Oscar Wilde. How was Norfolk? Very flat Norfolk, says the man, looking at the girl. She says, don't be rude. You think, oh. Anyway, you have to think about that one very carefully. Not too carefully, please. Anyway, Hilary Mantel. So, Hilary Mantel, she's won the Booker Prize twice. Astonishing to win a major literary prize. Even more astonishing to win it twice. Even more astonishing, possibly, to win it if you are a woman. The glass ceiling. So, I think there's a lot of women here. You know, again, so much to do. So much to do. You cannot sit here just learning. You have to be creative as well. You can't be passive in your university. It's something which I'm having a much wider conversation about. How to be active, how to make the university yours. It's terribly important. You have to decide what you are going to do. It's not just about writing your essay, finishing the assignment that you've been given. You have to do more! You have to do so much more. These assignments are the bare minimum. And I have this awful feeling from that sort of stir of excitement that went round the table that A, that's not the first time someone said that, and B, that maybe there was a sort of guilty grin on one or two people's faces. So, oh no, no, please don't repeat the guilty grin, I can't bear it. I really do feel what teachers ask you to do, this is the bare minimum. You should do more. You should surprise your teachers. You will never know about it while you're in the university, but many years later, you will be told. And they really will enjoy the fact that you surprised them and you did more or you did something unusual. I did a series of lectures in Birmingham University many years ago now. It was the first time I lectured in a university. I was terrified. And I was introduced by the person who had been my tutor in Oxford. His name was Bishop Callistos Ware. He was a very venerable bishop. In fact, he's not even a bishop now. He's a metropolitan. He's even more important. And he has his beard. And the funny bit about this was that the people in the audience were looking from him to me, and then looking from me to him, and smiling. And I asked one of them afterwards, why are you smiling? And I said, well, we were wondering who was actually speaking. Because I had adopted so many of his mannerisms. And now I think my mannerisms are mine. But I know that in my mind, when I'm thinking about speaking, he is one of the people, he's one of the icons that I always think about when I'm speaking in public. He was very impressive. He is very impressive. But he introduced me on this occasion, and he said, "Every week, for fully 2 terms, Tim would come to my room and read me an essay on a subject of my choosing. And I never knew what he was going to say. It was always unusual, always surprising Tim." And I thought, how on earth do I follow that? But it was so nice to know that all my effort to try and say something unusual about the Cappadocian Fathers and Gregory Palamas and various things paid off. He actually enjoyed it. That, you know, he'd heard these essay topics for 20, 25, 30 years, again and again, every term. And at least with me, he thought I was unusual and surprising. You know, I can't ask for a better testament, a better testimony. Right, now let's move on to, just before I do, his Dark Materials trilogy, Philip Pullman, which I think, and I've highlighted the 4 books, I think, which I think you should read, and if you don't read them, you should shoot yourself, really, and then write your novel, From the Grave. His Dark Materials, you should all go out and buy this novel today. I have no watch. This is just completely theatrical gesture there. But if you had a watch, you'd see, is there enough time? You should go and buy it today. Get the Kindle edition. Talking books. You can then put earphones on and walk with great respect around the university listening to English. It can become a permanent thing. You could be eating in Victor's... In Victor's Cafe, I can't remember what it's called, listening to English. It would be wonderful. So, his Dark Materials trilogy, if you don't remember the name of the 3 books, The Golden Compass, or... What's it? What? Northern Lights, The Subtle Knife, The Amber Spyglass. Intelligent... fantasy, maybe written for children, but way beyond something that would be exclusively for children. This is Narnia for adults. It's unpredictable, surprising, extraordinary stuff, and it also introduces you to the idea that the person who is telling you the story doesn't necessarily have to be consistent, or even right. The hero in one book is the villain in another. Oh, it's just so exciting. I could get more excited, perhaps, by Philip Pullman than I can by Jane Austen. No, I couldn't. Number 2, The Remains of the Day. Ishiguro. The Unconsoled is very good, but The Remains of the Day is an essential book for you to read. Number 2. Number 3... I think you should read Devil May Care by Sebastian Faulks. If you want to be brave, read Birdsong, but definitely read something by Sebastian Faulks. Those are 3. The 4th one is Ian McEwan, Atonement. Don't just stop at the film. And there's a 5th one I've highlighted, which is Mural Spark, The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie, because I think it's tremendous. And that's an example where the book... is brilliant, and the film is brilliant. Certainly the film with Maggie Smith. She has this wonderful soft Scottish accent which you get from educated Edinburgh. And she says, "My girls are all broody girls, and I am in my prime." And when one of the girls betrays her, she screams, "Assassin!" And, you know... She, rather like Hughie Grant, you can't really imagine anybody else playing that part. various people have tried, and you will find on the internet various other versions of the Prime Miss Jean Brodie. And they're not as good. Now, about a boy, and I'm the notes I made here are mostly notes I made before I read it all. So, and if I can read it in a night, you can read it. So, I remember reading this book shortly after it came out. I disliked it intensely. Then I saw the film and I warmed to it a lot more. Last night, reading the book, I must say I enjoyed it far more than I thought I would. It was one of those books that, frankly, if I didn't have to talk about it, I would never have picked up again. And I'm rather pleased that I did. So I think you've had a very nice experience. I have problems. I still have problems with Will. He's a conceited, arrogant, self-centred, not really redeemed character in any possible way. And I have problems with Marcus. I think he's a self-centred, arrogant, not really redeemed character in any possible way. Now, Marcus has an excuse because he has a difficult mother. Will has no excuse that we know of, but I suspect he had a difficult mother and he may have had a difficult father. But he's 35 years old. I also think Will suffers from being an improbable character. I don't know very many 35-year-old men in England, even if they have an income from their father's record, who'd still do nothing. The list of his achievements in, I think, the beginning of chapter 2 is really quite shameful. It says what he's done, how many women he's met and all this sort of stuff, and how many points he scores for each. Do you remember that bit? I don't really like it. But anyway, when I was reading it all together, because I think the first time I read it over a period of about 4 months while I was reading one or two other things. And I think probably it doesn't benefit from being read slowly. It benefits from being read like a play. It benefits from being read fast, because I don't think it is a novel. I think it is a play. It's a play with interrupted description, with description interrupting the dialogue. Think about it. The dialogue is rather brilliant, actually, and this is what struck me more and more, that Nick Hornby has managed to find a voice for Marcus and a voice for Will, which both those voices are different. And Ellie and all these other characters that we meet, all of them have got distinctive voices. I'm not sure the characters do very much. I'm not sure they change very much. Which, by my criterion of judging a novel, puts this very close to Lord of the Rings. But, of course, I adore Lord of the Rings. So, About a Boy is About a Boy. I'm going to read you what I wrote first. About a Boy is About a Boy who has trouble dealing with his current life. He is lonely at home and at school. His mother is depressed after a failed love affair and moving from Cambridge to London. When she sends him off with a friend, Susie, and he meets Susie's boyfriend, Will, there is an incident in the park. Marcus kills a duck. And when he gets home, he finds his mother has attempted suicide. The boy calls this the Dead Duck Day. After this day, things can never be the same. Now, my fear about reading this novel and then writing about it and talking about it is that that's basically where your interest stops. People tend, I suspect, to talk about the duck incident or the suicide incident, and they tend not to look much further. You all know the duck and the suicide incident, don't you? Yes. But I think there's more interesting things. I think the really interesting thing is the party towards the end, when Nick has to reveal that he's been lying about Ned. What does he reveal that he's lying about Marcus? I can't remember anyway. But it's the Christmas party. Yes, it's about Ned. So he has to reveal that he's been lying about Ned. And the series of lies catches up. And Will does this embarrassed English thing, which, of course, Hugh Grant does so brilliantly too. Marcus, throughout the book, plays a game of playing off the adults, which I recognise as something that children of a certain age do rather well. And he realises he's onto a good thing by picking up secret information when he goes round to Will's house and realises that Will couldn't possibly have a child. This is secret bargaining information. And I think the reason I first found this book unpleasant is because I didn't like Marcus and I didn't like Will. And even once I'd seen the film, where actually you like both of them immediately, because they're very well cast. I didn't go back to the book until I was forced to. Reading it all in one go, I realise I do in fact like Will, although I think I've got problems with him still. I like him despite himself, and I liked Marcus almost from the moment he appeared in the first page, because he's present. Why are we sympathetic about Marcus in the first page? Anybody? The opening page of the book. Can we go to it for a second? Because it sort of sums up. How do I go back to page one? Oh gosh. There we are. Is that it? Yeah, and I've got a picture of a penguin. Now I've got reviews, A Touching Tale, Nick Hornby. Here we are. Have you split up now? Are you being funny? He's talking to his mother, who's being quite defensive. So we see Marcus, firstly, through the eyes of his mother. Because his mother is clearly depressed, you get that on literally on page two. Is that page two I've got? Where she says, things aren't always as they seem. Where is it now? He'd quite liked Roger and the three of them. Yes, Marcus, he's gone. I think I'm not going to be able to find it. But Marcus immediately turns the conversation away from the idea about his mother's boyfriend to the idea of pizza, and the chapter finishes with a discussion about pizza. We come down to the real essentials of a boy's life. The pizza is soggier in London than it is in Cambridge. Why? And Marcus is very logical about all these things. It's soggier because it has to travel further in London, although it's made by the same firm. So suddenly you think, you know, this is actually quite an intelligent boy. And he's having a difficult time. If you go over, I don't know whether I can actually find the party scene. Can anybody find the party scene at the end? I may have made a note, actually, which pages. Let me go through them. Marcus feels responsible for his mother and her problems. He feels inadequate. By befriending Will, he sorts out lots of his problems at once. He has a friend. He has a potential mate for his mother. And if his mother and Will got together, that's the first plan. If Will and his mother and his mother became an item, then he could stop worrying about his mother. But the evidence that we get in the first chapter is that he's not really worrying about his mother, he's worrying about his pizza. The worry isn't expressed verbally. And what's interesting, reading this at speed, is how many things are not expressed in the novel verbally. Although this is a novel with a lot of dialogue, a lot of the important things are not in fact said. And the duck story actually sums that up rather well. No, you don't actually see the point where he throws the bread in the water, I think. Do you in the novel? You don't see it. You don't see it in the novel, you don't see it, I think, in the film. Actually, you almost see it in the film. But in the novel, I think we've got a scene where Will and... Is it Susie at that point? Susie. Will and Susie are having a discussion about... It might even be about Ned.
About children.
It is about children, absolutely. Because Will has decided that he's going to score more if he dates single women with children. So he invents his children. So something that comes across again very early on is that Marcus and Will are exactly the same age mentally. That's summed up right at the beginning when Will starts lying for Marcus to the park keeper and using Susie's child as an excuse. Irony. Really, irony is the key to all good writing. Can you think of some ironic moments for me?
From the book,
yes.
About duck's death.
Well, that's ironic, but I think we can overdo the duck's death. Can we move on a little bit?
And Will always kept forgetting whether his son was supposed to be named Ted or Ned.
Yes. Yes.
And we got
those rather nice little points in the novel where I think her name is supposed to be Paula. Mm-hmm. And there's a point, if I remember rightly, where her name is in brackets, mm-hmm. and he learnt this from somebody else. Or, mm-hmm. That's delicious, humorous writing. Is that ironic? I'm not sure that's particularly ironic. There's a nice example of irony towards the beginning where he's asked to be a godfather. He's asked to be a godfather in one sentence, and in the previous sentence he says how much he hates children. I think that's a wonderful example. I've got here ridiculous pivotal situations, bumbling embarrassment. Both Marcus and Will, they both find Marcus's mother more attractive because she tried to kill herself. That's deeply ironic. Deceit. Deceit is interesting in a novel, often because we know what the truth is. Will realizes he likes meeting single mothers. The group spat is terribly funny because we see it initially from Marcus's point of view. Oh no, I don't have to go on a picnic with that group, do I? And then we get conversation from Will and Susie in the spat group. That's like an extended lie anyway, and Will is inventing his child, his wife. The wonderful comments where he's getting angry about his wife and then trying not to be angry about his wife. And is it Rachel by that point who says, she's... One chapter begins with bitch. Do you remember that? Oh, the word bitch, incidentally, in English has a different meaning to the meaning it has in American. So do be careful. The word bitch in English, they both refer to female dogs. The word bitch in English generally means badly behaved. Garrulous, somebody who is speaking badly, is more likely to be called a bitch in England, in English. And we wouldn't confine the word bitch to women. Men can equally be bitchy. However, in America, The word tends to refer to somebody who has been doing something sexual. So it's a much worse meaning in American English than it is in British English. So Americans think that we are terribly, terribly shocking because we use this word so often. Son of a bitch in American English would be probably one of the worst things you can ever say. In English, we would just think, My mother was bitchy sometimes. But not in an American sense, I trust. So do be aware of that. It's one of the many references in this book that can cause problems when you're reading it as foreigners. You assume that what you hear from Hollywood is what we believe. Not at all. The other thing I rather like is Ali wearing his headphones. Do you remember that? And lying and saying, can you hear what I'm saying? No, yes. He doesn't hear a word. That's with Rachel. And Ali is Rachel's 12-year-old son. I think I'm repeating myself here. Plans. Marcus engineers for Will and his mother, Fiona. No, we've got that. Marcus meets Ellie. Oh, who is Kurt Cobain?
Leader of Nirvana.
Is he real?
Yes.
Oh, right, good. That's nice to know. Did he really die?
Yes.
Right. Did Ellie really throw a boot through the window? No. Nice thing, because do you think the film is an improvement on the book when it comes to the end? Nick Hornby said it was perfectly in keeping with the spirit of the book. So I think it gets his approval. We know what we're talking about, yes? Yes, yes, yes? The change between the book and the film, you've all read that far. Everyone's gone very quiet. No one's going to know. Has anybody read the end of the book?
Yes.
Right, so you know at the end of the book, in the book, there's all this business about the boy going off to Cambridge and then getting arrested with Ellie, who gets very upset about this singer from Nirvana who dies. I thought he was fictitious. I'm very excited to know that he was real. And then there's a big reunion in the police station. I think what Nick Hornby is saying is probably that happiness is not to be found as a couple. Happiness is to be found in community. I don't know whether I agree with that. But in the film, you've got this thing where Hugh Grant plays the guitar badly. Do you think that's better? You've got none of the trip to Cambridge. Do you think the trip to Cambridge is a good thing? We know that the mother and Marcus come from Cambridge, so the trip back to Cambridge to see his father and all that sort of stuff, is that good or bad? How does it feel? And then he takes Ellie with him.
As it turned out, it was bad.
Yes, but in terms of plotting, do you think it's a good plot device, or do you think the playing of the guitar in the film is a better plot device?
I also enjoy the idea with the school concert and Will playing the guitar, just because in the film not so very much attention was given to Marcus's father anyway. So that's why this ending in the film somehow felt warmer, if I can put it like that.
The relationship is so much more clearly between Will and Marcus.
Yeah.
Whereas in the book, it's not quite sure where the relationship is. Will is a sort of surrogate parent. Well, he doesn't need the surrogate parent if the real parent is so ready to be there. You can think that relationship is going to continue in the film. That relationship is not going to continue, I think, in the book. I also find the trainer's sequence really rather dodgy. And And again, in the film, I'm not sure whether... The film and the book are quite close to each other, with the trainers and Marcus's mother misreading that story. Well, she read it exactly as anybody would read it. Some strange man that you've only just met has given you trainers. Why is that? He has a special interest in your feet. It is quite dodgy, but there's something about the story in both the film and the book that I feel is out of line with the actual story. And I don't quite know how a mother who would have reacted so strongly against the trainers initially then comes to accept Will at all, or Will can actually show his face there. We know Will has a certain amount of chutzpah, but I find it very difficult to recover from that allegation. Does it make any sense? So it's one of the plot devices which I find slightly unbelievable. If I were writing that novel, the novel would end there. That would be the end of the relationship. I can't see how that relationship can continue after that allegation. Because the excuse for Marcus to go round to Will again, or the excuse for Will and Marcus to see each other again, isn't very convincing. What do you think? Everyone's gone very quiet. I'm trying to move beyond the duck and the suicide. So I know you can all talk very enthusiastically about the duck and the suicide. You don't seem so enthusiastic about the latter part of the book. He does.
And he got involved somehow. Though he promised never again, but still, it is looking for several times.
Sorry about these noises on here. It's my digestion. I had lunch very late. Yes, so you don't really believe it, do you?
I can't say that for me was a bit annoying. But yes, it was a bit strange that... Yes.
But equally, how could he stop at that point? He would then be even more involved in the situation, and even more questions would be asked. He would probably be arrested, I think. The whole subject seems to me to be a very uncomfortable subject. That I don't think is resolved properly in the book, and I think it's actually done for a laugh. I think there's a number of moments in the book where Nick Hornby thought, this would be a good joke. We'll put this in. And the mother gets very angry about the trainers. Bullying. Do you know this word, bully?
Yes.
Do you know where it comes from? Has anybody looked at the etymology of bullying?
Bull?
No, nothing to do with bull. Well, bulldog is the British image, is a symbol of Britain from the 18th century. British bulldogs. During the Napoleonic Wars, the sailors, who were often press-ganged into fighting the French on board these huge boats, and being at sea for months at a time, people were press-ganged into taking the king's shilling. So if you took a shilling, if you took money to pay for your for your being a sailor, then you were forced to follow through and go on board the boat. So it was very dangerous drinking beer in pubs with strangers in Portsmouth and these harbour pubs. The press gang officers would place coins in the bottom of a mug and then give you a beer. And you would say, oh, yes, thank you very much for the beer. You drink the beer, and at the bottom of the glass would be this coin, and that means you had accepted enrolment as a sailor. It's why in Britain, beer is now served traditionally in a glass, so that you could look underneath and see whether there was a coin in the bottom of it and whether you could in fact accept the beer. Even tankards, the silver tankards which people used to drink beer out of, or ale. In Germany, they have these lovely tankards with little figures on them. You've seen them, and little tops. We had that as well. But from the beginning of the 18th century, they had a glass bottom, so you could check to see whether there was a coin in them. So people were press-ganged into the Navy. They didn't want to be in the Navy, and they were there for many months, often years at a time. And they were treated very harshly. A lot of people were badly wounded. They had their legs sawn off without anaesthetic, and so on. Very, very nasty, violent life. And the propaganda that was being put about was that Britain was being saved by our boys at sea. And the boys at sea were living on boiled beef, which had been kept in salt water. Only towards the end of the period did people realise that they should also be eating lemons and oranges to stop them getting scurvy. The boiled beef was called bully beef. Boiled beef, bullied beef, bully. So we moved from bully beef to bully boys. Our brave bully boys are defending our country from the malicious French. Look at them going across the Atlantic to fight in the Caribbean. The bully boys. So our bully boys would come back to England, and everybody would cheer, and everybody would be very grateful to them for saving us from the French. Until the French were defeated at the Battle of Trafalgar. And about that time, suddenly we had to get rid of our navy, because our navy was too big. So we docked many ships in these little ports in the south of England, and the bully boys left the ships and, oh, what am I going to do for the evening? You. Why haven't you been fighting the French?
Because I'm a little farmer.
Bang! and then probably they would see a girl and take her off, and unspeakable things would happen. And because of this, the bully boys got a different reputation. They got a reputation, oh my goodness, we lock your doors, the bully boys are coming. So the word which was originally a word of pride, the bully boys, becomes a word of fear. The bully boys, ah, lock up your daughters, hide. The bully boys are coming off the boat and they will attack you because they have nothing better to do. Bully changed its meaning completely from being something which was a figure of pride to something, a figure of scorn, a figure of hate and fear. And have we run over time? How much time do we have? I'm going to tidy up very quickly and then I ask some questions. So then today the word bully is something that we hear a great deal of. Oh my goodness, it just goes on and on. The word bully we hear a great deal of today because we believe that children should not be bullied. And, of course, there's the obvious bullying when one person hits another. There's less obvious bullying when somebody... There's less obvious bullying when somebody calls somebody something else. So when somebody says nasty things to somebody. But something that I'm very conscious of as a teacher is that I also have an opportunity to bully people. I can bully my students. I can ask you uncomfortable questions. You know, if I was particularly nasty and particularly aggressive, I could reduce some of my students to tears. This is appalling. And something which you must think of, you're in a pedagogical university. You need to think of your responsibility as a teacher, as a potential teacher, your responsibility towards children, because they're very delicate creatures. And, for example, if you see somebody hitting somebody else, what are you going to do? Hit them? You just perpetuate this cycle of violence. And that brings me back to my biggest concern about a boy, which is that there's a cycle of deceit going on, which is never really resolved. Question. Do you agree? It doesn't seem to me to be a healthy relationship, and it doesn't seem to me to be a productive relationship, and it seems to me to be entirely based on deceit. Very funny, very funny. And I was much more entertained than I expected I would be. But was I morally uplifted? No, I don't think I was. Any comments? Yes.
Well, actually, I was quite amazed when I read this chapter about the first visit of Max to Will. And it was a surprise for me. There was a real, I can say, a delight that a grown-up man would open his flat to a complete stranger, a very small one, but a complete stranger, and there would be any kind of communication between them. Later on, when I discussed this chapter with just my students, I asked them, would you open the door to a small, well, not very small, just to a teenager, to a kid? Would you try to communicate? Would you try to continue this relationship? And basically, people said, like, if I know that there is any case of emergency, I would let him in just for a day. But after that, I would try to find his mother and never try to communicate with this guy again, because he's a child, I'm a grown-up man, so what should have we in common, really? So in this way, the most surprising and the strangest moment in the book for me personally. So that's why in this particular respect, I think I absolutely agree with you. Just it was done probably for the purpose of humor, of interest, just a kind of a literary device, stylistic device, but I don't think that it's true to life.
Yes. Yes, I find it actually very, very worrying. Yes, I wouldn't like to be put in that situation myself. But again, you focused on an event towards the beginning of the book. Can anybody say the same thing with reference to something towards the end of the book? Can I challenge you to do it at some point before the end of the term? Actually, look towards the end of the book, because it does give the impression that you've only read the beginning. Okay, please go on and read the end of the book. Please, don't rely on Hugh Grant. Lovely though he may be, don't rely on Hugh Grant. Now, as I say, I think there are better books to read, but what else have you read? Some of you have read the Golding book, Lord of the Flies. Anything else? There's a complete silence now. Has anybody read anything for pleasure? What have you read for pleasure? Look, you're doing English. Can I recommend, please, that something that you are reading for pleasure in Russian, you just read it in English. Do you read books for pleasure in Russian? Is anybody going to say we've got too much work to do? Who's reading a book for pleasure in Russian? Thank God. Right. Is anybody reading a really good book for pleasure in Russian? Is anybody reading a translation of a book which was otherwise written in English? There you are. What are you reading?
I have just read it. It was To Kill a Mockingbird.
Oh, no. You should read it in English.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, but have a look at more modern novels. Really, your next novel, why don't you get two copies? One in English and one in Russian, and you can start reading it in Russian. When you feel really lazy, you can continue reading it. You can read the Russian one in the bath, but you can read the English one in the metro and look really posh. You know, ooh, look. Just make sure you've got it the right way round. but please, get hold of two copies of the same novel. That was how I started reading when I was trying to read in another language. And I started in Greek and I finished in English. And I struggled. No, the other way around. I did start in Greek and then I finished in English. I struggled in the Greek, and the more exciting the story got, I had to continue reading it in English. But at least I read some of it in Greek. And you should do the same thing. You should start doing things which you naturally do in Russian. You should do them in English. What about video games? How many of you play video games in English? Only one of you. Two. And you're both girls. You know this. Surely boys play video games too. You don't. You do it in Russian. Do you play video games? No. Nobody. Nobody. You don't play video, or you don't want to admit it. Does anybody else play video games? There you are. In Russian.
In English first.
Thank God. And your English gets better and better the more video games you play. Don't
you? What's the point of playing video games in Russian?
I agree. You have to wait until it's translated.
Yeah, this is a nice way to improve my English. So
it's a very good way to improve your English. Also, what is it? Films. How many people watch the film when you get your DVD, and you've got the option of subtitles? How many people put Russian subtitles onto their DVDs? Nobody. Excellent. How many people put English subtitles onto their DVDs? Don't struggle. Struggle. Try to work out what they're saying. Even if they're speaking American, I know it's not real English, but even if they're speaking American or they're from Scotland, struggle. The cinema, television and DVDs are already a passive experience. So you need to make it as active as possible. Do a little bit of work. You can always stop your DVD and go back and just check. Did they really say that? So subtitles. Try to look at the films in the original. I highly recommend you look at television series. TV is often a little bit faster. It lasts longer. The dialogue is often there's much more dialogue. In films, particularly in Hollywood films, the producers think that you can't really do dialogue. So there's not very much dialogue. There's a lot of special effects and action, not very much dialogue. Television, you get more dialogue. Does anybody look at Game of Thrones?
Yes.
In English?
Yes.
Lovely. With subtitles?
No.
Lovely. It gets better and better. And it's all very exciting. Has anybody read the books? In English? Good. Continue reading. Continue reading. Next time I come along, we will talk about Fire and Ice, is it, or something? Yeah. And Game of Thrones. And what's the other ones? What are the other ones called? Yeah. I don't know. I've not read. I've read little bits of lots of them when I've seen them lying around, and I picked them up and I started reading. I've not got my own copies. Yeah? Okay. And there's another example where the television series and the books are actually quite different and becoming more different now. The two things are going off, you know, into two parallel universes. No, there's nothing else I want to say, is there? I need to let you go because we've got to the end of the class. Do you have any questions? Yes.
So first of all, I would like to apologize because we kept silent during your lecture. But
have I been talking about something you know nothing about? No.
No, actually, we read about the poem, but it was like 2.5 years ago.
No. So what are you reading now?
What are you reading now?
I thought you were doing about a boy for an exam this term. I'm so sorry to be so boring.
So it wasn't boring, but it was kind of hard to follow you in terms of a plot.
Ah! Right.
But anyway, my question is, and I think that I'm speaking on behalf of all students, and unfortunately, due to the lack of time, we have a really limited choice of what to read and when to read.
I know.
And as for me, I have a great collection of British writers like Charles Dickens, Jack London, James Joyce with his Ulysses.
Don't read Ulysses, it's so difficult.
Yeah,
have you read it?
No, but I'm about to.
Be brave.
The question is, what are the reasons for us to actually choose modern English literature?
Because it will contain dialogue and words which we are using today, and you can continue applying these things. Whereas if you're reading Dickens, lovely, gorgeous though Dickens is, it's not language we use in everyday life. So you're having to learn it twice. It's rather like doing Japanese. You have to learn two languages rather than one. Oh, I don't know. Does that answer? So have a look at the books which I recommended for the 21st century. But you know how much I love Dickens, and I love Jane Austen, I love Thomas Hardy, and I love James Joyce. James Joyce, I would recommend Portrait of an Artist as a Young Man rather than Ulysses. Anything else?
And just to thank you, because it was very interesting, and we really appreciate your time and your efforts, though you have very little period of time.
No, well, I've got another entire lesson on Shakespeare, every play. But I'm going to publish that on the internet, so you can get that at some later stage. But when I come back, I don't know whether I'll get a chance to see you next week. Probably not. But when I come back, what I need to know is, what do you want me to talk about? So if you want to contact me by email or something, please do, and just tell me what I can do to help, because I want to help you. I want to help you do better English. I want to help you be better students. I want to help you structure your life, and I want at least four of you to write the next great English novel. I am looking forward to it. If you have a pen and you can write this down accurately, I'll give you my email address, which of course is not for anybody else, so we're not going to record it. We are of course recording it. Don't worry, but this is the secret, you see. So it's Wilson, Wilson, all lowercase, _ Tim, TIM, and then the digit 2, at that thing, which is called an arabesque. It has a name. At sky.com. And that will get me wherever I am. Just write to me and say, I really want to talk on blah, 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 blah. It doesn't matter what it is, really. I would be very happy to come and talk to you. Or set up a seminar where you talk more to me. I would love to hear what you have to say. So if you have a nasty essay or something to write, call me. I have a nasty essay to write. Help. And if you've got to write an essay instead of me, on the internet I have a YouTube video on how to write an essay. How to write a good essay. Tim Wilson, and it's under my film channel, but I will put a link. I will make sure there's a link in the blog here to that. There's also, I am in the process of doing 5-minute summaries of all the English grammar that you ever need. I think I have 13 videos. I've put 6 on the internet so far. You have to keep stopping the video and looking at all the text, because there's a lot of details. There's also some funny pictures. So it's not terribly hard work, I think, but it will sum everything up. The longest video that I've done for this is on the definite article, where there are so many reasons why we use the definite article, and even I didn't know them all. So I did the research, I made the video, and that will be one of them which will be uploaded shortly after I get back to England. And I would hope to come back in February. So you will have a month without me, and then I will come back for about 2 weeks, and I will keep coming back for about 2 weeks each time. So you have to tell me, and you have to tell your tutors, what you want me to do. Otherwise, you know, I just come and talk about Shakespeare, or I come and talk about Nick, what's his name? Hornby! Who really I don't want to talk about, but, you know, I will do whatever I'm told to do. I'm very obedient. Now, the other thing I would say that you've got to get into a habit of doing, please, if somebody asks you to write an essay or if somebody asks you to do something, do it. This is your job. Okay? And you must learn in university how to do something even when you don't want to do it, even when you've got no time to do it. You must sit up and continue. You must meet your deadline. Here is your lifeline, here is your deadline. You've got to cross that. You've got to cross that, otherwise you will die. Okay? And this is what you learn at university. You learn how to meet the deadline no matter what is happening. Okay? That you don't learn at school. At school you say,
I wasn't well.
At university you can't say that. Okay? That's where you are taking personal responsibility for your lives. So, in the meantime, because I don't think I will see you before, have a very happy new year and a very nice Christmas, and I will see you in 2016. Gosh, that sounds so grown up, doesn't it? And some of you will have novels. Please, just walk around with a novel. It will make life so much more exciting.